Good morning, Evangels, and welcome to Chapel at Mid-America Christian University. I'm so glad to see each and every one of you here today. I want to welcome all of those who are joining us online. We're so glad you're a part of our MacU family. Thank you for tuning in to Chapel today. It's Friday, and I hope you have some great plans for the weekend. Looking forward to a great weekend on campus and off campus as well. I'm excited because Mama G is here with us this morning, and she and I are celebrating 23 years of marriage on Sunday. So happy anniversary. I pray that God will fill your life with the joy of a great marriage, Christian marriage, just like Stephanie and I have had. We want to be an example for you in that regard because we fall more in love with God and more in love with each other every single day. And so it truly is special to be able to celebrate her today. We're just glad you're here. I want to invite you to stand and to greet someone that you don't know. Just say, welcome, glad you're here, and we'll get started with worship in just a second. Thanks for doing this. Proud of you all.
Good morning.
Thanks for doing this.
Good morning, MacU. Let's worship together. Breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King above all kings.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Come on.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is a unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my
His unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing. All that you've done for me. All that you've done for me.
Let's praise him this morning.
1 Thessalonians 5:16-18 says, always be joyful, never stop praying. Be thankful in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you who belong to Christ Jesus. So as we sing this next song, I want you to remember that no matter what you're going through, no matter what you're facing, that there's always a hallelujah to be sung.
You've got a lion inside of those bones. from all my soul. Don't you get shy on me, lift up your song. You've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord.
Father, we're so thankful that you will never fail. We're so thankful that in times when people have failed us and we feel like there's nobody else around, Lord, you are never failing. And we are never alone, and your word promises that. We can never flee from your presence because that's not who you are, God. Abba, we love you. And we're thankful that we have a privilege and opportunity to freely worship you in this place, God. I pray that you would just be in the message that you've anointed over Kevin, that you've just spoken over his heart, Lord. I pray that that message would just transcend over this whole room and you would just touch every heart today, soften every heart today, God. We praise you, Lord. We love you, God. Do what only you can do in this place, Jesus. Amen.
Good morning, Matthew.
Morning.
Give it up for that worship team one more time. So good. So good. They're awesome. They're awesome. Well, some of you are wondering why I'm up here, and I won't be up here for long, so I promise not to take much of your time, but I have the privilege of introducing our speaker this morning, and this is a man that we are all familiar with, that we all love. He is a servant who never looks for praise, never looks for recognition, never is going out of his way to be seen. He is in the shadows, just working to serve you and to love you, and he does. He loves you a lot, and I have, I know, learned a lot from this man, because he just loves people, and he shows what it's like to follow Jesus wholeheartedly, and is just a great example of a leader. And so please, Matthew, help me welcome, give a warm Matthew welcome, should I say, to our campus pastor, Kevin Duguay.
Thanks so much, Jordan. I appreciate you.
Love you. Love you.
Thank you, Corbin. I'll give you your $10 later. Man, how is everyone? Good? You know, everyone's been kind of saying the same thing as I've been asking them how they've been doing so far. Hey, how are you doing? Good, just tired. Good, just busy. So before we start, I did buy a couple of gift cards from Starbucks. Thank you, PG, for Starbucks. Yeah, incentive to listen to Kevin preach, right? Okay, the first gift card is for resident students. Who got the least amount of sleep last night? Because this card is, how many hours? Cody? 0.5? Can anyone beat 0.5? Talon, did you even sleep last night? I feel like Talon is... You actually slept last night. Give me some times, y'all. Huh? 11 hours of sleep? Praise the Lord. This ain't for you. No sleep? Lexi, come on. Can we welcome Lexi? She needs this card, y'all. Want to come up here? Yeah. Who says no to free Starbucks? I know, like, I'm walking up here. Everyone's staring at me. What do I do? There you go. You're very welcome. Our next card for the commuters. Yeah, I want to show some love to the commuters. Who lives the furthest from campus? Talon. Hoel commutes from Paraguay. Oh, how far? 15 minutes. Does anyone have a lot? Yes. Oh, can anyone be 45 minutes? I think you won this card, man. I think you deserve this card. Oh, man. Oh, man. Yeah. And as growingly tired we're all going to get this semester, those gift cards are going to come in handy. This morning, I wanted to start with doing something really spiritual, really special. I'm going to show you some memes. So we're going to work through some memes that I feel like everyone can relate with. Can we see that first meme? So, like, everyone's tired, everyone's anxious, everyone's overwhelmed. This is what this one says. Me trying to excel in my career, maintain a social life, drink enough water, exercise, text everyone back, stay sane, survive, and be happy. Is anyone there right now? Some of you? Okay, next one. Me trying to survive. Is that anyone else? Right? Yes. I hear an amen in that one. All right, let's look at the next one. This is a popular one. This is old. This is fine. This is fine. Burn. Next meme. This is my favorite one. When someone says, "Don't be anxious," and your anxiety is cured. Oh, man. Is it the last one? Is it the last meme? Oh, okay. Can you multitask? Yes, actually, I am losing my mind and chilling at the same time. Most Gen Z. I think that was the last one. So I've actually been praying for a really long time over this particular message. I've been praying for you all, just asking God, like, what is it that these students this semester need to hear about? And this word kept coming back to me over and over and over. It was rest. It was rest. And not like the kind of rest that some of y'all get in the back in chapel when you're sleeping. I'm talking about like a spiritual rest. I love y'all so much, I promise. I gotta tease y'all a little bit. I wanna give some prefaces to this text, and as I do, I'm gonna ask Tish and Howell to come on stage because they're gonna read our scripture this morning. Tish, Howell, would you come up? Yes, give it up for Tish and Howell. So let me just set the scene. Today's scripture comes from the Gospel of Matthew. If you don't know what that is, there are four Gospels. What they are basically biographies of the life and ministry of Jesus. And at this part, Jesus is teaching and talking to people, and I feel like this scripture speaks directly to us this morning. Give it up for Tish. This is you, sir. We have HH2. I think you're good.
All right.
Yeah.
Good morning. I'm going to read from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 11, verse 28 to 30. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light.
Thank you, brother. Thank you so much. Thank you. And I asked Joel if he would read the same scripture in Spanish.
Okay, voy a leer Mateo 11, 28 al 30. Vengan a mí, todos ustedes que están cansados y agobiados, y yo les daré descanso. Carguen con mi yugo y aprendan de mí, pues yo soy apacible y humilde de corazón, y encontrarán descanso para su alma, porque mi yugo es suave y mi carga es liviana.
Thank you guys so much. And just real quick, can we just give some, we give praise and glory and thanks to the worship team who is incredible. Can we give praise to the media and sound team in the back? Y'all, they work so hard to make sure chapel goes smoothly. Also our IT team to make sure our live stream is running smooth. I know y'all get into a bunch of hiccups also, so thank you. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened. Some of you are like, I'm already feeling this message. This verse is for me. I want to show you, this is my family. This is my wife, Linda, and my son, Wilder. They're actually here. You may hear him. Is he sleeping? Yeah, no, he's not sleeping. You're going to hear a lot of amens from Wilder. Yeah. Thank you guys for being here. I want to show you guys a picture. President Greenwald, you would be familiar with this picture. People in Oklahoma may not be as familiar, except for, you know, the other day. There's a lot of shoveling in the Northeast. Some of you come from countries where there's way more snow than America's ever seen, and so you know this picture really well. Well, I remember we didn't have a whole lot of snow days because the Northeast is just always prepared for snow. Well, when it was really early in the morning and there was snow falling, I would not be happy. I'd be really bummed out because guess what? I'm shoveling. That's what that means. I have to wake up early, put on like 6 layers of clothes, my gloves, and grab the shovel, and then you just start getting to work. And especially if it was a weekend, you know, I was out there all day. My father and I would shovel for other people's properties, and I just remember getting tired. Sometimes my back would hurt, and he and I would just get exhausted. Until he bought a snowblower. And it was like, oh my gosh, how come we've never done this before? Why were we working so hard at this task when there was always a better way? There was always a better way. Today, what I want to talk to you guys about is Jesus' invitation to rest. Is there a better way? Some of you are familiar with this passage, extremely familiar. But I want to ask a question. Who here is pretty bad at rest? Yeah, most of us, a lot of us. I'm going to ask you some questions about something that psychologists call hurry sickness. And I'm going to ask some questions. If you relate to this or if you agree with this, just raise your hand. When you're driving, you look ahead to see which lane is moving the fastest, and you move into that lane. When you're checking out at a store, you choose the shortest line. If you're not working on something, you rely on stimulation from activity, entertainment, or noise. When you aren't doing anything, you feel guilty or restless. You rely on caffeine to feel energetic and focused. Y'all, give me back my Starbucks cards. No? Okay. You tend to do two or three things at the same time to be more productive. Not to play psychologist on stage, but they say it's self-diagnosable if you have hurry sickness, and if you've answered more than two of them, you probably struggle from hurry sickness. There are some interesting things about this passage at first glance. It all looks like is Jesus says, hey, you need some rest? Come to me. It's so much deeper than that. He is offering an alternative way of living. Not a life of anxiety, but a life full of rest. Not a life of worrying about the future, but a life of being fully present in the present. Not a life of impressing or measuring up, but a life of wholeness. And you don't have to raise your hand for this one. You could, you know, answer in your head. Does this sound good to anybody in this room? Some of you are saying, it kind of sounds too good to believe. I live in a culture in America where it's so fast-paced and everyone is in a hurry. I get it. But if we're going to just kind of wrap our minds around Jesus' invitation to rest, I have four things to tell you guys about this scripture. The first one, we got to look at who the invitation is from. Jesus says, come to me. Come to me. If we were to be honest, a lot of times when we're stressed or overwhelmed, turning to Jesus to pray is not our first instinct for a lot of us. Even as y'all's pastor, I can tell you, if I am overwhelmed or stressed, my very first thought isn't turn to Jesus. A lot of times it's let's eat something really sweet and like waste time watching shorts, reels, and TikToks. Like, is that anybody else in this room? That's like my first instinct. And I've learned that those things don't actually ever give me rest. They kind of just get me sort of high. I'm going to show you guys a picture of my son from the other day playing in the snow. Oh, Wilder. I know. It's my son. One day when I was coming home from work, I opened the door, and usually Wilder gets excited. He goes like, duh, and like runs over to me. But this day, he was not happy. He was moaning, groaning, sounded like he was crying, but there were no tears. He was throwing things all over the place. He was taking sips of his milk, threw his milk, took a bite of his cookie, threw his cookie. Does anyone know what is wrong with Wilder? He is tired. He was a tired boy. And so, like, I bent down, I was like, Wilder, like, just come to dad, come to dad. He pushed my hands away, kept walking around, milk, cookie, throw, torture our dogs, all that stuff. Yeah. Eventually, though, I was chasing him around, just come to your dad, come to your dad. He turned around, put his arms around my neck, gave in, and literally a few seconds of bouncing, he was KO'd. He could finally find rest in his father. Blaise Pascal once said, there is a God-shaped vacuum in the heart of every man which cannot be filled by any created thing, but only by God, the Creator, made known through Jesus. Guys, being exhausted, anxious, overwhelmed, tired are, unfortunately, kind of inescapable in this culture. How we respond is not. Right now, there are 50 million people suffering from anxiety in America. And here's the thing, both the secular, non-religious world and the church and everyone seem to have the same idea. This world can be really tough, hard, busy, and overwhelming. But the best the secular world has to offer is distractions and short-time highs. Currently, there are a lot of us in this room who aren't good at rest because we aren't seeking rest. from their busy and stressful lives. They're just seeking distractions and short-time highs. And when I say highs, I'm not just saying like marijuana and stuff like that. There are all kinds of cultural highs that we engage in to distract ourselves from our overwhelming lives. For some of us, it is social media. If you're brave enough to look at your time spent on your apps on your phone, it's extremely humbling, and you'd rather not get that report from your phone on how much time you spend on Instagram or TikTok, Snapchat, all these things. For some of you, it's forgetting about your problems through getting plastered or smoking pot. And I understand those things like have an effect on our brain chemistry to where we don't maybe feel overwhelmed or anxious. But reality is literally waiting for us after we come down or up from those things. And if that speaks to you this morning, you know exactly what that feels like. For some of you, it might be getting attention on social media, a certain kind of attention. For others, it might be having sex. For others, it might be using pornography, highs that are short-term, when the real world, this anxious, tough world, is just waiting for you at the other side of these things. And this is not your pastor shaming you. This is me just being realistic and knowing the nature of these things. Because here's the problem. A lot of us are seeking to get high. Jesus is offering us to become whole. And one is so much better than the other. So, you don't have to talk about it right now amongst your friends, and you can, I encourage you to, but think about some of these things. What are things that get you high? And sometimes we justify, oh, my thing that gets me high is not as bad as theirs. Oh, for me, I just want a lot of influence and success, but I don't do that. For me, I'm just trying to impress everybody, and when I do, that gets me high, and that's fine, that's good. But there's still highs, and one day it'll still just be just that. And so I want to move on to, we talked about who the invitation is from, let's talk about who the invitation is for. All you who are weary and burdened, Jesus is inviting two kinds of people to his kind of rest. Those who are working themselves to stress, worry, and exhaustion, and those who are overburdened by empty religion. Let me explain. The Greek word for worry best transliterates in English to tired, worn out, or the product of large amounts of work, or exhausted from grief. In modern language, it could be summed up by the word hurry. Psychologist Dr. Kevin Chapman says, Americans are conditioned to be very high in achievement motivation. Listen, with many of us learning over time that high achievement equals happiness. And it is a lie. Caleb Shermer from Student Success was telling me about this thing called the cult of efficiency. I'd never heard of it before. But basically what it is, it's a belief that the more productive and efficient and the more you do in your day, the better of a human being you are. And what lie that is also. In the Western world, in America and in Europe, we very much follow suit with that. We are no longer seeking a day that makes us feel fulfilled or whole, but a day where we got a lot of stuff done, where we were productive. So that was a weary people. And some of you are like, that sounds like me. These are the burdened people. Usually this word, burdened, when it was referred to by a rabbi, it was a word that you use burning, putting weight on top of an animal. And so he was referring to all of these Hebrew listeners listening to Jesus' teaching who have been taught their whole lives, if you follow the 613 Mosaic commandments, you will be whole, you will be good. And Jesus is saying, this is just burdening you. So I'm speaking to y'all who've grown up in church. To y'all who have served church your whole life, your parents brought you to church, and you just were always expected to be the church version of who you are. Trying to do every single thing right. I don't cuss, I don't drink, I don't do any of these things. Like I'm staying pure, I don't watch this, I do children's church, I do all these things. I'm following every commandment in the Bible. I try to honor my parents, I try to be honest, I try not to lie. But all it did was leave you with stress, anxiety, low self-esteem, and a part of yourself that you hide to everybody else. And maybe that's you this morning. I want to show you a picture from an artwork from the Guggenheim Museum in 2016. It's called Can't Help Myself. And some of you may have seen this on social media. It was a really big hit on TikTok and Facebook for a really long time. This machine was designed to do two things. It was purposely built in with little holes on the bottom to leak its own oil. And so it would scoop its oil back into itself. And also, it had the AI technology for it. It was able to wave to people looking at it. Really neat. It's kind of weird, but it's really, really, really cool to watch a video. I encourage you to watch it. Well, it was also designed for this, too. It was going to lose the efficiency to scoop oil back into itself over time. And so you see, like, this was actually around for a few years. In the first year, it was scooping really good, waving, having relationships with other people. It's really weird, a robot having relationships with people. And then over time, it just kept scooping more oil into itself. And then all it was doing was trying to not die. It was not making interactions with people anymore. And for some of you, you're looking at that picture and saying, that's me. That's me. Trying to find rest for yourself, by yourself, is hard. And honestly, impossible. There are those of you sometimes, if you were to be really honest, you're trying so hard, and you think that all this hard work will be worth it because I'm going to be happy one day once I get all this hard work done. I'm going to score enough points where I get more scholarships and opportunities later on. I'm going to get good enough grades to get this degree so I can go to get a master's to have this job, and then I'm going to find rest and be happy. I'm going to find this person to be in a relationship with, and this, then I'm going to have rest in my heart. I'm finally going to impress and please my parents, and finally they'll get off my back. And these are all the lies we tell ourselves. And so we end up like this robotic arm up here. Guys, more doesn't mean better. Here are some quotes I want to tell you guys about being busy and being in a hurry. Can we see the first one? This is by Swiss psychologist Carl Jung. Hurry isn't of the devil. Hurry is the devil. Next slide. Love and hurry are fundamentally incompatible. Love always takes time, and time is the one thing hurried people don't have. John Ortberg. Next one's my favorite. If the devil can't make you sin, he'll make you busy. Corrie Ten Boom. It's really interesting. Busyness and hurriness acts the same way as sin does. It separates us from our time with God and our time with other people. Next, let's talk about what the invitation is to. We talked about who it was from, who it was for. Now, what is Jesus inviting us to? In this verse, Jesus says, "And I will give you rest." While many of us tend to believe that at the end of all the hard work we do, we will finally have rest, Jesus is saying that he is the source of rest, and it could be had right now. The word rest in Greek actually has a Hebrew equivalent in the Old Testament, and the word is Sabbath. And later on, there's actually a story right after Jesus is teaching them where he's eating and picking off grains with his disciples, and that is considered work. And you're not supposed to work on the Sabbath, which was Saturday, according to the Jews. And these religious leaders are like, what are you doing? You are working on the Sabbath. This is not good. This is not lawful. You don't even follow our rules. And basically, Jesus turns around and says, I am the Sabbath. Whew. Genesis chapter 2. We have recorded the creation story. You guys know that according to the Bible, the earth and the universe was created in 6 days, and on the seventh day, God rested. Well, on the first through sixth day, it said, he explained what happened. And then it says, and then there was morning, and then there was evening, to explain that the days were moving. The only spot in Genesis 2 where it doesn't say it became morning and then evening is on the seventh day when God rested. And I've heard the question, like, if God's all powerful, how come he needed to rest? He didn't need to rest. This was actually the design for our universe, the Sabbath. The day where humans were already made. Every single thing was provided for. Every ounce of food and water that every animal and human being needed was there for us. It was a place in Eden where you couldn't get hurt. You were never going to be hungry or thirsty or tired. It was just mankind, nature, and God. Sounds really good. Sounds really good. But this is the thing that God wanted for us, and this is what Jesus wants for you all. Not just in heaven after you die on earth. This could be accessed right now through Jesus. Because there was a belief that Sabbath was going to help us with our shalom. If you've ever heard the word shalom, it means peace. But it really means, in when you break down the Hebrew, when a piece that has been missing has been filled and been made whole. And some of you, you're feeling that this morning. There's a piece missing. And I'm going to move forward to our last piece of our sermon. We'll talk about how to accept this invitation. Some of you are still either on the fence or like, yeah, I don't know. That's great. God sees you, knows where you're at, loves you, and is patient. But if you're someone so far has been like, I want that. And either you're like, I don't know if it's too good to believe, or I don't know how. This is how. Jesus says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me. We're going to break that down. But before we do, let's talk about what a yoke is. Some of you don't know what a yoke is. I had to look it up when I first became a Christian. I was like, I don't know what a yoke is. Did I just spell yoke wrong? Is it an egg? So we're going to look at that next picture. So a yoke was an agrarian tool. It's like a piece of wood that fastened two oxen together to till the ground for farm work. This is what a yoke was for. I don't know about y'all, this is a really weird thing to offer for rest. It's like, come to me and I'll give you a mattress. I'll give you a pillow. I'll let you sleep in my buddy's dorm. Like, you would think that would be the thing. Yeah, a yoke? That sounds like more work. Jesus was actually saying, attach yourself to me. Do life with me. Then he says this. He says, learn from me. This is a call to discipleship. And a better word, according to a lot of theologians, would have been apprenticeship. And you already know what that is. An apprentice is someone who studies and works and follows somebody so they can be more like this person to do something specific. And for plumbers and electricians, you apprentice them so you could be a plumber or an electrician. You apprentice Jesus onto how to life. And that's what it is to disciple Jesus. And you will find rest for your souls. And to be clear, I know there are a lot of interpretations and definitions of what a soul is. The soul is the part of you that is the center of all your thoughts, desires, and feelings. The Greek is actually psyche, where we get our English word psychology. You will find rest for these things. And he says, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So that word easy in English would have been better as well-fitting or custom-made. The opportunity and invitation to do life with God was made for you, is what Jesus is saying. It was really common because a lot of rabbis during this time were using the yoke as an example, as yoking yourself to the Mosaic Law or the 613 commandments. They said, yoke yourself to the 613 commandments. You will find rest for your souls. You will find peace. You will live a good life. Jesus is telling them, no. Yoke yourself to me. Don't do life for God. Do life with God is what this invitation is. And unfortunately, we have not done a great job as the church explaining this concept. Sometimes you fall into this fancy word called legalism, where you follow all these rules and you're right with God. You're a good Christian. But Jesus is saying, no, follow me, have a relationship with me, or else all you have is empty religion. Linda and I have a nephew named Weston, and he is a firecracker. And I have a knack of asking kids who are around 6 to 8 years old, like, what do you want to be when you grow up? Because usually it's crazy. It's like a dinosaur or, you know, something like weird, or a robot. You can't be either of those things. And so I asked Weston. I was completely expecting dinosaur because he loves dinosaurs. I said, what do you want to be when you grow up? And before I tell you what he said, his father owns a power washing business in Oklahoma and does a really great job. And always watches his dad, comes with him when they're presenting their business to other places. So I asked Weston, what do you want to be when you grow up? He said, I want to be a power washer. And what I was getting was this. Weston didn't want to be a power washer, I don't think, to become a power washer. He wanted to be like his father. And that's exactly what discipleship is. How can we be more like Jesus and live the kind of life he lived? Guys, a disciple's goal was not to learn what the rabbi taught. It was to become who the rabbi was. So if Jesus is our teacher, our rabbi, how are we becoming more like Jesus? Most of Jesus' interactions in the Gospels were interruptions. He was going somewhere or doing something, and when someone would come up to him, Jesus, you need to do this. And he was never anxious or overwhelmed. He was always calm and present. C.S. Lewis says that how you respond to an interruption reveals who you really are. And when you're in a hurry, and when you're busy and you're overwhelmed, how do you respond to an interruption? Is it anxiety? Is it worry? Is it stress? Is it frustration or anger? Have I been there? Absolutely. Absolutely. Constantly trying to check my heart when I'm busy that you guys and my family and my wife and my son are not interruptions. These are the things that are eternal, our relationships. And so, with that being said, we move on to the next thing. It says, for my yoke is easy, my burden is light. I want to set up a contrast for you guys. Can we go to the next slide? Nathan? Yes. So, in the beginning, I noticed Jesus saying this. He says, all you who are weary and burdened. If this is you this morning, he is saying the way you are doing life is producing these two things. You are becoming weary and burdened. But my way is easy and light. So if you want, this is your choice. This is an invitation, not a rule, an invitation. You can keep using your shovel in this life if you want to. That is up to you. You can keep toiling and being anxious and being overly busy and overly tired and just seeking highs in between all of your responsibilities, or you can live a life with rest where you're doing all of these things but remembering at the end of the day our relationship with God and the people around us are the most important. As finding rest for our souls, I didn't come here to give you guys like a step-by-step process of like a self-help thing. You just got to do this, 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 and this. It's not practical. Finding rest for your soul is not practical. It's relational with Jesus. In a moment, I'm going to play a song. I would have asked a singer to do it, but it's something for you guys to reflect over this. But I'm going to give you guys four ways you can actively take this message with you and practice rest. We see the first one. You can take a picture of this. You can ask me for them later. Start your day, each day this week, reading this passage 3 times slowly. And then sit with God in silence for 5 minutes. Some of you guys, I don't have time for that. Try it. Try it. If you guys don't think I'm not busy, I am. I'm really busy. And I'm not burdened by it, because if I don't take this time for myself each day, I am no good to any of you or my family or to Jesus. So if I can do this, I promise you can. Try it for the next 7 days. That's probably a total of 6 or 7 minutes. Next practice. Make it a habit to tell God what's been good in your life and what's been bothering you. Just be honest. God, I met this really cute girl today. God, I got this A today. God, I had to go to another chapel today. Really annoyed about it. Be honest. Be honest. I didn't want to go to chapel today. I had to go. I would rather you tell God that if that meant you were praying. I promise. Number three, if you are a student, consider coming to our small groups. We are currently working on a devotional called The Ruthless Elimination of Hurry. And it's about finding rest for your soul and living a life of rest amidst the culture of busyness and hurriness. And happens every Monday night at 8 p.m. And it happens in those dorms, second floor McCutcheon for men, first floor Southwest for women. And last slide. If you all feel overwhelmed and want to talk to somebody, me and my wife Linda are here for you guys. Maybe something's bothering you. Maybe something has been making you anxious or overwhelmed. You have questions about the Bible or today's message. We're here for you. The only reason why, after weeks of prayer with my wife, that I took this job, it's because I prayed to God that whoever was going to be here as y'all's campus pastor would love you and serve you the best. And so I know some of you know me a little bit more or a little bit less than other people. I don't want to be a stranger to y'all. You can text us or call us at any time. And I was going to show you a song, but I don't want to keep you guys past the time. I want to reread today's scripture in the Message translation. And I want you guys to listen. And if you want, close your eyes and just listen to me. This is Jesus speaking. Are you tired? Worn out? Burned out on religion? Come to me. Get away with me and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me and you'll learn to live freely and lightly. This is the only spot that's been recorded in the New Testament where Jesus himself says, come to me. You don't have to be good enough. You don't have to be Christian enough. You don't need to have read enough of the Bible to come to Jesus. And for some of you, this has become a broken record in the Western world to come to Jesus. I am not calling you to empty religion. I am not calling you to come to more chapels or go to church more. I am not calling you to read your Bible 3 hours every single day. I'm not saying those things are bad. This is an invitation I am extending to you to a life of freedom and rest. Let's bow our heads. I would like to pray for you guys. Oh, God. When we stop to look away from our distractions for a second, Lord, we are tired. We are overwhelmed. There's so much to do. Some of us exerting ourselves more mentally than others. Some of us exerting ourselves more physically. There are students and staff and faculty here with multiple jobs while they're being students, God. There are students here who are working their tails off being athletes to bring praise to MacU and the team. And they're tired. There are students here who don't know what their future is going to look like. There are students here who are anxious because they're just trying to get through in this life. There are students sitting here struggling and no one else knows about it, God, but you know about it. You see the hole in their hearts. You see the lack of rest in their souls, Lord. And Lord, there are some here who don't know how lost and broken and empty that they are right now, God. Lord, I pray for students who may have rejected you or didn't want to really do life with you, for you to soften their hearts, for them to reconsider doing life with you, God. For we know that is the only way we can have rest. God, I pray for all of us, including myself, to not be a hypocrite, to lean into you, to eliminate hurry from our lives, to depend on you, to move in kingdom rhythm, God, that is side by side with you. Jesus, whatever every single person here is going through, I pray blessings and healing over that right now in Jesus' name. Things going on in their family, grades, personal lives, relationships, God, I pray for that. Because I know there's hurting in this room. I know there's emptiness in this room. Help this day and this message not be another chapel. Help us to know this is an opportunity for us to live a better way. But we love you, and we thank you. And we pray all of this in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you all so much. Have a great day. Y'all are dismissed.
Get up.